And I'm desperate for you, Jesus. Desperate for you, Lord. I'm desperate for you, Jesus. So desperate for you, Lord. I'm desperate for you, Jesus. Desperate for you, Lord. I'm desperate for you, Jesus. Desperate for you, Lord. I'm desperate for you, Jesus. So desperate for you, Lord. I'm desperate for you, Jesus. So desperate for you, Lord. I'm desperate for you, Jesus. So desperate for you, Lord. Well, I'm desperate for you, Jesus. So desperate for you, Lord. I'm desperate for you, Jesus. So desperate for you, Lord. I'm desperate for you, Jesus. So desperate for you, Lord. I'm desperate for you, Jesus. So desperate for you, Lord. Oh, I'm desperate for you, Jesus. So desperate for you, Lord. Oh, I'm desperate for you, Jesus. So desperate for you, Lord. Oh, I'm desperate for you, Jesus. So desperate for you, Lord. Ooh, I'm desperate for you, Jesus. So desperate for you, Lord. More and more and more of you, Lord. More and more and more of you. More and more and more of you, Lord. More and more and more of you. More and more and more of you, Lord. More and more and more of you. More and more and more of you, Lord. More and more and more of you. And I'm desperate for you, Lord. Oh, I'm desperate for you, Lord. Oh, I'm desperate. I'm desperate for you, Lord. I'm desperate for you, Lord. Hungry and thirsty. Hungry and thirsty for you, Lord. desperate for you, Lord. Oh, I'm desperate for you, Lord. Desperate for you. Only for you. Only for you. But only for you. Only for you, Jesus. Only for you. Only for you, Lord. Only for you. Only for you. Only for you, Jesus. Only for you. Only for you. Only for you. But only for you. Wherever you lead me, I will follow. Wherever you lead me, I will follow. Wherever you lead me, I will follow. Wherever you lead me, I will follow.
Wherever you lead me,
I will follow wherever you lead me. I will follow.
For the Lord is
Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His name. For the Lord He reigns. For the Lord He reigns high above all.
Bless the Lord,
Bless his holy name. We bless your 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 holy name. We adore you, Lord. We adore you, Lord. We adore you, call you Savior. What a privilege to call you Master. What a privilege to call you Savior. Lord Jesus Christ, what a privilege to call you Master. What a privilege to call you Savior. What a heritage we have in you, Lord. What a heritage we have in you, Lord. What destiny you have for us, Lord. What destiny you have for us, Lord. We honor you, Lord. We honor you, Lord. We honor you. We honor you. We honor you. We honor you. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of them that bring good news, the glad tidings of great joy. Glad tidings of great joy. We bring good news. We bring good news to those around us, to those of the city, to those of the field, to those of the mountains, to those of the valley. We bring good news. We bring good news. We stand in your glory. Our hearts bowed low before you, but we stand in your glory. And we stand in awe of you, Lord. We stand in awe of you, Lord. We stand in awe of you, Lord. We stand in awe of you. We stand in awe of you. How beautiful your glory, Lord. How beautiful your presence, Lord. More to be desired than gold are your words, Lord. Than much fine gold or silver. Precious your words. To us, our Lord. Precious your words are to us, Lord.
Yes, Father.
Precious your presence.
Precious are your words.
Precious Holy Spirit. Make us so sensitive to your yieldings and movings. Lord, to be so yielded to your movings. Precious Holy Spirit.
Precious.
Precious fire
precious
of God.
Fire.
Ignite every heart here, Lord.
Yes,
Father. Ignite every heart here, Father. Ignite our hearts for you to where we burn so bright with your glory. To where we burn so bright with your presence. With your overwhelming glory. Bend us, oh God. Lord, that everything about our lives. world fashioned according to your word. Lord, that there be the divine order of heaven in all our operations, God, as we cooperate with you, Father. Oh, the joy of your presence, Lord. Oh, the peace of your presence, God. Oh, the power of your glory. Bend each one of us, Lord. Bend all of us, God.
Yes, Father.
Break every part of us, Lord,
yes,
for you.
Lord.
Have your way, Lord.
Have
your perfect way, Lord. Your perfect way, Lord.
Yes, Father.
Your perfect way, you, Lord.
Your perfect way, you, Lord. Hashibasi basi tiyano so. Sushi apayana.
And now God is a consuming fire. Our 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 God is a consuming fire. Yes, our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. Our God, He is a consuming fire. trust is in you, Father. All our trust is in you. All our confidence, all our hope, all our assurance in you, Lord Jesus. Rock of our salvation. You're the rock of my salvation. The rock of my salvation. God is the Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in Him.
Happy are the people whose God is the Lord. Happy are the people whose trust is in Him.
Happy are the people whose God is the Lord.
Happy are the people whose trust is in Him.
Happy are the people whose God is the Lord.
Are the people whose trust is in Him.
Happy are the people whose God is Lord.
Happy are the people whose trust is in Him.
You are our God, and beside you there is none, Lord. You are our God forever, and we are your people forever.
You set my feet.
shed my feet are dancing. You fill my heart with praise. You shed my feet are dancing. You fill my heart with praise. You shed my feet are dancing. You fill my heart with praise. Because of your goodness. Oh, what goodness, Father. Oh, what goodness, Lord. Oh, what goodness. Oh, what goodness. Oh, what grace. Oh, what love. What marvelous love. What marvelous love. What marvelous love. Cloud of your glory, the oil of anointing. Oh, the cloud of your glory, the oil of anointing. the cloud of your glory, the oil of oh, the cloud of your glory, the oil of anointing, the cloud of your glory, the oil of that you pour out. You anoint our heads with oil. You fill our cup to where it's overflowing. Lord, you anoint our heads with oil. And fill our cup to overflowing. Not just one time, but all the time. Because of your goodness. Because of your love. Because of your faithfulness. Oh, Lord. Your faithfulness. Breath of God, breathe on us, fresh wind of heaven. Breath of God, breathe on us, fresh wind of heaven. Breath of God, breathe on us, fresh wind of heaven. Breath of God. Breathe on us, fresh wind of even now. Breath of God, breathe on us, fresh wind of heaven. Breath of God, breathe on us, fresh wind of heaven. Breath of God, breathe on us. Fresh wind of heaven, breath of God, breathe on us. Fresh wind of heaven. Oh, breath of God, breathe on us. Fresh wind of heaven, breath of God, breathe on us. Fresh wind of heaven, breath of God, breathe on us. Fresh wind of heaven, breath of God, breathe on us, fresh wind of heaven. Breath of God, breathe on us, fresh wind of heaven. Breath of God, breathe on us, fresh wind of heaven. Us, fresh wind of heaven, breath of God, breathe on us, fresh wind of heaven, breath of God,
breathe on us,
fresh
wind of heaven.
Breath of God,
breathe on us,
fresh wind of heaven.
Lord Jesus, we worship you, we praise you. Glory to your name, Jesus. Before you, Father, in praise and adoration. Holy is our God and mighty is his name. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, glory. Thank you, Jesus, for you have gotten us the victory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We have the victory in the name of Jesus. Oh, glory. Glory to your name, Jesus. Oh, praise you, Father. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Oh, praise you, Jesus. Oh, glory, 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 glory to the name of the Lord. Oh, Father, you are worthy, you are worthy, you are worthy. And Father, we're so thankful that we get to stand in your presence in this realm of your glory. Oh Lord, that you would bring us up into these heavenly places. Oh, and you would show us such great glory. You would show us, Father, your ways. You would show us, Father, your goodness. Oh Father, that you would open up heaven and you show us your loving kindness, oh God. Oh, Father, what an honor it is to be able to open our mouth and worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Oh, Father, just to stand and behold you and worship you, Father. Oh, Father, we want to give you all the praise and the glory and the honor that is due your name. Father, I thank you that you've allowed us to worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, we don't have to worship you after human ability. But Father, we are taken up into the realms of your glory, into the realms of your spirit, and we can worship you in spirit and in truth. Oh, hallelujah. Yeah. Father, you are so good. You are so good, Lord. You're so glorious. You're so mighty. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Woo! Halevese. Halela lolo bokoche. Halela lolo bokoche lala. Sote alene nemo sote. Lia shuna ki delen mo shina. Zilele lala lolo bandele lolo shela. Jibele lolo bokota. Sumbandele lolo shi. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Well, I think if somebody handed some of you in this place $1 million right now, you would not be quite as sedate as you are. I know a few that can get very loud when they get excited about something. But there's nothing more to be excited about than the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. There's nothing more to be excited about than he made us heir and joint heir with Jesus Christ the righteous. Woo! Glory. Oh, he's worthy of every bit of praise that you can give him, that you can pour out on him. Oh, he's worthy. He is worthy. He is worthy. Kalesa. Leda Moshe. You think of King David. When finally the Ark of the Covenant, finally he gets the Ark of the Covenant back into Jerusalem. And oh, he was this man after God's own heart. He was so in love with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He was so in love with him. And when that Ark of the Covenant came walking into Jerusalem, it came back. David just lost it. It says that he danced before the Lord with all of his might. It says that he played before his father. He just got busy thanking and praising the Lord. He was joyous and excited and exuberant. Oh, hallelujah. About the presence of the Lord coming back into Jerusalem, for which the Ark of the Covenant, which was fashioned after the Ark that was in heaven, that God told Moses to fashion it exactly like it. The holies of holies, where God would come down and he would dwell with men and his presence would sit at that Ark of the Covenant. Oh, we are the temple of the Most High God, and the Holy Spirit has come. The Holy Spirit has come to live and dwell on the inside of us. Glory to his name. Hallelujah. Oh, praise you, Jesus. And King David, not even knowing what we have in this fullness that we have received in him, he played and worshiped and danced before the Lord. He put off his robe of royalty and he just worshiped the King. He worshiped the King. Hallelujah. And there'll be those like Michal, his wife, that will despise that worship because they don't understand it. It doesn't look proper. You shouldn't act like that if you're a king. You disdained yourself before all the inhabitants of Israel. Oh, no, he didn't. He set in order the kingdom because of his love and his worship for God. He made it to where there would never be one of his seed that did not sit upon the throne. Hallelujah, as long as there was a throne. Because of his love and his adoration, and because he poured himself out on the one he loved, and he wasn't busy and distracted by other things. When the presence of the Lord was coming in, he was caught up. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Father wants us to be caught up in the realms of his glory. He wants us to enter his courts with thanksgiving. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. This is prayer. This is coming into his presence. Oh, hallelujah. Rejoicing with thanksgiving and praise. Thanksgiving and praise. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, listen. Dancing and rejoicing and singing and shouting in the name of the Lord to the Almighty. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Balasso. Balasinera. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. For you alone, oh Lord, are worthy of the praises of your people. Hallelujah. We may just start out in just a simple obedience of a hop or a jump. But I tell you what, if you pour your heart, if your heart is caught up with him, he'll set your feet a dancing. He'll set your heart a rejoicing too. Your heart will be so rejoicing, your feet won't know how to stand still. Oh, hallelujah, because you'll rejoice with him. Oh, praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Woo! Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo! Woo-hoo! Oh, praise you, Jesus. Woo, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Glory to your name, Lord. Mesudola. Yisela boshela namasai. Yeta. Psalms 149, praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. You know, when Nehemiah was out building, he came back to Israel and he built to build the wall for Jerusalem. They had to have a trowel in one hand and a sword in the other. They had to be ready and vigilant. And what he said was, the joy of the Lord is your strength. Hallelujah. This is how you fight. This is how you're prepared. This is how you're aware. The joy of the Lord is your strength. You know, I've been going over so many ways. There's so many places of prayer. There's so many postures of prayer. Different types of praying when you pray, but every one of them leads to the glory of His presence that captivates. And it goes deeper and deeper and deeper in His presence as we seek His face. It doesn't matter which posture of prayer. You get up in a different place in God. You went deeper. And oh, how precious it is to know that our prayers are bottled up in a censer and they're brought up before the throne of God. Oh, thank you, Jesus. And it's a sweet-smelling savor to Him. Oh, hallelujah. And all heaven is earth is moved by the prayer of faith, a prayer of the saints of God that believe what they're saying, that believe that their God is able. You know, faith is not believing God will do something. Faith is knowing that He will. Faith is knowing. It is hooked up with what God's doing. God said it. That settles it. And it's done in Jesus' name. It's not a maybe. It's not a hope. It is a fact. When God speaks it, it happens. When God says it, it happens. Oh, glory to your name, Jesus. Praise ye the Lord. Sing unto the Lord a new song. Oh, and when you begin to praise Him, that new song comes out. I don't care if you can't sing. If you're like me and you cannot carry a tune, if you will, as you start to praise Him, I write all kinds of songs. When I'm at home and nobody can hear me and have to go through the torture of hearing me singing, my beloved causes that to flow through me as I worship Him. And that's a place of prayer. Do you realize that worship is a place of prayer? When we come in here, you know, at first everybody from 6 to 7 o'clock might be sitting down or walking around or whatever and praying in the different postures that they're praying in. But when we come in and we begin to worship, that worship goes up before the throne room and it's a prayer. It's a prayer to Him. It's praise and prayer, and we're entering into His courts, and we're beholding Him. Do we realize? Do we realize that we're having audience with the King? The King has bid us come. Come before His throne. Come into His courts. Oh, thank you, Jesus. And it makes us look like people that other people don't understand. And so there's a lot of David's wives that, you know, they've got their opinion. But she kind of lost out on everything from that moment on. That was it for her. That was all. She was put away from that point on by the Lord, by the Spirit of the Lord. Because you don't touch God's anointed. You keep your hands and your tongue and your mouth off of God's anointed. Stay over here in the praise. You got a battle coming against you, stay over here in the praise. You got discouragement coming against you, get over here in the praise. You got depression, that demon of hell, it's a big ugly one. It's a big ugly engulfing demon that tries to capture you in his grips. And I mean, don't let him get his grip around you, because it's very challenging to get his grips off. Not for God, but for your head. But if that ugly, stinking thing tries to come against you, open your mouth and rejoice and praise Him. Get up. Get up and shout. Get up and rejoice. Get up and sing. Get up. And declare the word of the Lord in praise and worship. And it puts the enemy to flight. Hallelujah. Do we understand that the gates of hell cannot prevail against His church? They cannot prevail against His church. So are you in His church? Then get up and put the army of the aliens to flight. Get busy. Don't sit back and chicken at the enemy's little words that he breathes out, or his things that he throws out against us. The demon spirits of hell, they have no power in the name of Jesus. Your heart, you could be in a situation, your heart could be pounding like this because you heard something and your heart start pounding. You know, say you're walking down the road in the middle of the wilderness and you hear, "Rawr!" And your heart's... But in the name of Jesus, he's given us all power and dominion over everything on this earth and the principalities and powers of darkness. We don't have to be afraid of nothing. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Yea, though I walk through my job, or any persecution, I will fear not man. I won't fear man, and I won't fear the enemy, because I've got heaven on my side, and there's more with us than there is with them. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, Jesus. It's praise. It's praise. It's praise and worship. It's prayer with authority. It's letting God take a hold of you in that secret place where you go hide with just you and Jesus. That secret place in the midnight hour. I encourage you, if you don't know about that secret place in the midnight hour where it gets real quiet and still and no one's around and no one's there to interrupt you and the phone's not ringing, go to bed really early and ask God to do the same for you as he did with David, as he woke up in the midnight hours. He woke up in the night watches and he worshiped the Lord. That still place in his presence where he speaks to you, where he reveals himself to you. But I tell you, it's awesome when you're going through the biggest battles of your life and you're facing the toughest things and you thought you could not go through this and it was impossible that this would ever be able to happen to you. And you say, "Holy Spirit, come and lead me and guide me through this." You will know him and you will come to a revelation and an understanding of the presence of the Lord like never before. So count it all joy. Yeah. Count it all joy. Because you're getting ready to know God in a bigger and a deeper way. And if you want to go deeper in God, you're going to go through some stuff. So you can learn to be excited about what you're going through. Hallelujah. So you can go, "That victory's won. Hallelujah. That one's down. Hallelujah. I turned the armies of the aliens to flight on that. I am more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ who loved me and gave himself for me." Oh, praise you, Jesus. I'm co-laboring with Jesus right now, and I think he's winning this battle. Now I know he's winning this battle. Hallelujah. Because simply, I'm not looking to me. Simply, I am not looking to me. I'm calling upon him who is mighty to save. The arm of the Lord is mighty. He has all the strength I need. He has all the ability I need. He has all the power and the authority I need. And he said he gave it to his church. And that's me. There's a lot of people that claim to be in his church that are walking around defeated by the devil. But that's not his church. His church is those that conquer. His church that are those that are more than victorious. His church are those that believe what he said and live and walk it out. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. And it just starts by you not trusting in you, but trusting in all that he has done through you. When it gets really tough and you're getting under the battle, know that it's you and not him. And just fall down on your knees real quick and say, "Oh, Father, forgive me for trying to do your work. Forgive me for trying to do what only you can do. Oh, Lord, now I want to raise up and let you do this in me. Let you work this in me.
Yes.
Let you show forth your glory in me.
Yes.
Oh, praise you, Jesus. Those are the times we just need to go behold glory. We just need to go and look at the glory. We just need to go up to that secret place and look at the glory and be changed from glory to glory to glory to glory. I tell you what, when Moses was changed to the glory, when he went in the scripture where it's talking about that, being changed from glory to glory, before that it talks about Moses' face glowing so brightly that they had to come and veil his face before he could talk to the children of Israel because they could not bear the brightness and the glory of God that was on his face. And if he had that glory which was to be done away with, and we have much more, why aren't we in his presence to where they have to veil our face?
Right.
Oh, praise you, Jesus. When we have all of this, when we have all of this, this is what we have. The glory of his presence. It will change everything about you. Because you'll learn not to be you, but to be in him and him in you. Because that's what he prayed in John chapter 17. He didn't pray, oh God, help them. You know how we pray those prayers? You know how you hear so many people praying those prayers? Oh God, help them. He said, Lord, I pray that they are in me. And we, and as I am in you and you are in me, that they are in us. As I am in you and you are in me, that they become one with us. That's power.
Yes, it is.
That's authority.
Yes.
That's hidden Christ.
Right.
Him shining forth, not us shining forth. As long as we're going to drive and have a hold of the steering wheel, God is going to be patient and continually draw us to him, but we will not have that glory. We will not have that glory until we let go. As one preacher said, he looked at a man that came up to pray for him and wanted prayer. And he said, you have, you know, I've got a big church. I've got a huge church. I've got a massive children's ministry. I have all kinds of ministries going on. But you have power and you have a place in God. You have glory. I want what you have. And the man that was praying for him said, oh, you know, he just waiting on the Lord. And he goes, oh, no, you're not ready for this. You want to take the things of God and you want to use it to make your church bigger. No, it won't do because you're in the driver's seat and you're leading the way. And the church you have is about you and what you can build. And no, it won't do like this. And he said, what do I got to do? He says, well, you've got to let go of the steering wheel and you've got to get in the back. You've got to get out the door, open the back seat, and get in the back seat. And sit there and let Jesus drive. And they says, no, this isn't going to do for you either because you're going to reach up over the seat and you're going to try to help steer the car. He said, no. He said, you've got to get out of the car and you've got to take the key and go unlock the trunk. He said, and you've got to get in the trunk and close the trunk and stay there in the dark and let Jesus drive. You know, so many of us want all of these things in heaven, but we want to keep our hands on the steering wheel and we want to continue to control it. And we want to continually tell Father what to do. But when we step aside and we let the glory of the Lord take over. Huge change. And it comes through entering his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. It comes with knowing that he is the provider. And I'm going on with Psalms 149. Praise ye the Lord, singing to the Lord a new song, and his praise in the congregation of the saints. Let Israel rejoice. Let the abiding place rejoice in him. That made him, let the children of Zion be joyful in their king. Let us rejoice and be joyful in our king. Rejoice and be joyful in our king. Hallelujah. Let them praise his name in the dance. Hallelujah. Let them sing praises unto him with the timbrel and harp. For the Lord taketh pleasure in his people. Oh, that is so amazing.
Yes,
that Father takes pleasure in us. Yeah. Can you say that? Say, Father takes pleasure in me.
Father takes pleasure in me.
What is he talking about that he takes pleasure in? When we're praising him and rejoicing him, then's when he takes pleasure in us. He doesn't take pleasure in the griping and the complaining and the worrying and the stressing and the figuring it out and the looking at our circumstances. He takes pleasure when we rise up and we do what he's called us to do by his Spirit, what he's enabled us to do through the blood that he washed our sins away with, and through the power of the Holy Ghost that he gave us. He takes pleasure when we stand up and we allow him to be mighty in us and through us. That's what he takes pleasure in. Oh, hallelujah. He takes pleasure in his people. He will beautify the meek with salvation. Hallelujah. So it doesn't matter what you look like. He'll beautify you with his salvation. When the glory of the Lord is on you, it doesn't matter what you look like. I know, and you know, when I looked at Catherine Kuhlman when she was ministering, when I would watch her when I was a young girl, I didn't think about what she looked like. I saw the presence of God on her.
Amen.
Now, I thought she was different. And I knew to be very careful what you said about an anointed person. But I was asked by a minister, what do you think about this woman? And I stood there and I watched her for the first time. And she was so theatrical. Maybe I'm a little bit like that. I don't know. I get excited. But you just can't help it. You cannot help it. I tell you what, when you get caught up in the realms of his presence. Oh, praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. See, that's what prayer does. And what we're doing is praising. And prayer is praise, and praise is prayer, and this is worship. You don't want to miss out on this part of the service. Thank you, Jesus. Because you know what? It prepares you for the next part. Because just very clearly, you enter his gates with thanksgiving, his courts with praise. If you don't come here exuberant in that place of entering his gates with thanksgiving, his courts with praise, we're giving you an opportunity to bring you in. And I think that's how it started, the worship before the service, because the pastors got tired of walking into a bunch of people half asleep and, you know, just coming in with all their problems and their issues. And they must have thought, well, if we can get them praising and worshiping, the scripture says this is how they enter in. So if we can get them praising and worshiping, and we can get their mind on Jesus, and we can get them outside of their self, maybe we can minister to them. Because when you got a church full of people that are half asleep and all caught up in their thoughts about thinking about what they've got to get done, you can't get very far. People have got to be hungry, pulling on the anointing for God to speak. There's got to be somebody. I look for those ones that are pulling on the anointing. Those ones that are hungry. Those ones that came and said, Father, what are you saying? Father, I want to hear what you're saying. They're not coming to look at a person. They're not coming to look at who's standing up here or their ability, but they're coming to hear what Father's got to say. Because Father will use any hunk of clay. He used a donkey. He used a rooster. He'll use any one that will open their mouth. He had no one around but a donkey to talk to Balaam. Nobody else would be obedient, but that donkey obeyed. Nobody else could see the angel, but the donkey could. With the angel, for those that don't know, the angel with a sword drawn in his hand, ready to take Balaam down. Phew. The end of Balaam's life. The donkey could see it. So get past the vessel that God uses. And that's the thing with Catherine Kuhlman. It didn't matter. I saw the anointing. The presence of God. She glowed with the glory. But she said, here I am, Lord. And she went through a whole lot of stuff. If you know anything about her story, she went through a whole lot of stuff to get to where she was. She had to lay down a whole lot of things. She had to let go of things. She reached out a couple of times to grab what she wanted, and she almost lost the anointing over it completely for the rest of her life, but she had to put them down and walk away from them to be able to go back to the place that God wanted her to be. Most people just continue on because they count their lives dear to themselves instead of not counting their life dear to themselves, because they haven't seen or experienced that place of glory in him.
That one day as we're worshiping him, we'll just be translated from this realm to the next realm. As we're in that place of glory. That's how I'm going. In that place of glory. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We know 11 of his disciples were martyred. But in such a place of glory. Paul was headed straight there. He knew exactly what was going to come his way. And he was headed straight there. As fast as he could go. He's like, yeah, I already know it. Yeah, it's been prophesied and told me one person after another. Yes, and I'm going because my course is set. And I'm going to run my race and finish my course. This is what's set before me. Jesus endured the cross. He suffered the shame for the glory that was set before him. Why would men want to have their eyes on something that is so temporal that could last only 50, 60, 70, and if you're really blessed, 80, 90 years? So temporal, when all eternity we can have all of heaven. And oh, to think of that day that we go before him, what do we want to take to lay at his feet? That concerns me. That concerns me. What am I going to have to lay at his feet? Oh, Father, I need more time. I need to be more activated. I'm continually praying. Oh, Father God, make me that laborer that souls are compelled to come to you with. Lord, make me that person, oh God, that compels people, that has such an authority over the hearts and lives of men that they're compelled to come to you, Father. Because I know you and I behold you and I believe you. And I know it will happen. Coming to that place that there's just such an authority. Because I hear the Father say, speak, and the heart's pierced. I want to have so much to lay before him. But I mean, above all things, my love, my whole heart. Above all things. Because when we're captivated by him, and his love flows in us and through us, that's fulfilling everything that he's asked us to do. And then it compels us to do whatever he does. Ooh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, praise you, Father. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Psalms 150. Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him on this earth. Praise him in the sanctuary. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Are these your words? Is there praise coming forth from your lips? What comes forth from your lips? Do you think of continually Psalms 19, verse 14? Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart. That's what I'm thinking about. That's what's going on in me. Still your thoughts before the Lord. Check them, see where they're at. Are they running rampant, 90 to nothing on, from one thought to the next thought, over here, over there? Where are they? Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Are our meditations of him sweet? The sweet meditations. Do we meditate in the law of the Lord day and night? So we'll be like a tree planted by the rivers of living water, by the rivers of water. Where our leaf does not wither. And everything that we do prospers because of our meditation is on the law of the Lord. And in it, do we meditate day and night? You know, that was the key, you know, because as a young child, you know how the enemy tries to come in with young children and bring a scary thought in the middle of the night. They'll see something, and they bring that into their sleep, and they'll wake up with a scary thought, and then they want to come and get in mom's and dad's bed. And, I mean, even many adults have scary dreams, and they wake up from a dream. I mean, I've had dreams from heaven. I wake up gasping, you know, just going, oh, Father, what's going on? But, you know, scary dreams for kids will If you're teaching them to meditate on the law day and night, then you teach them. This is a key for waking up and people having these things that they're going through with fear. So it's in the daytime, it's in the nighttime, it's any time. You know, and the enemy will quit trying to wake you up and scare you if you wake up and your meditations are on the law of the Lord. Amen. And he gets to a place where he's scared of you waking up because you're turning the army of the aliens to flight. You're running. You're running off the powers of darkness. He won't mess with you when you wake up. And so, you know, I learned many years ago that when something was going on, my mind would get off in a place it shouldn't be, or something, you know, was attacking me or whatever. I would start looking at books of the Bible. Okay, Romans chapter 1, what is that about? What does that say? How many verses can I quote in there? Romans chapter 2, Romans chapter 3, Romans chapter 4, Romans chapter 5, Romans chapter 6. Just going through the Word. So, you know, like if I was in prison, could I write it all down? How much could I write down? How much would I know? And just, I tell you what, that'd captivate you. And then I'm like, man, I've got to know the Word more. I didn't know enough there. I didn't know what every chapter said. But I just literally take books and, you know, just start out with what was the topic. You know, in a situation where, you know, maybe you can't write something down or whatever. But your mind needs to be stayed on the law of the Lord. There is your protection. There is your guidance. There is your instruction to live in Him. There is your victory. There all fear and doubt and everything that does not belong to the child of the King has to flee. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Praise you, Father. Praise Him for His mighty acts. Praise Him according to His excellent greatness. Praise Him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise Him with the psaltery and harp. Praise Him with the timbrel and the dance. Praise Him with the string instruments and organs. You know what? This doesn't sound like a request to me. It sounds like instructions of what we're supposed to do. So when we're worshiping, we include everything, including the dance. Hallelujah. Praise Him upon the loud sounding cymbals. Wait, praise Him on the loud cymbal. Praise Him upon the high sounding cymbals. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord! Hallelujah! No battle that comes against you can stand that! Praise the Lord! I will not succumb to this circumstance. I will praise the Lord. I'm not going under, I'm going over through. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm not going to let whatever it is. And I'm just, you know, the Holy Spirit's reminding me of something that just really upsets your apple cart and makes you want to lash out and deal with the situation. I'm not going to succumb to what the enemy has tried to hold me captive by for so many years. I'm going to go, praise the Lord! I'm going to be thankful for what He's done. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Woo! Glory! Selemo shelala. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Over here in Philippians. Looking at this prayer right here. First, we got to start in verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord sometimes. Rejoice in the Lord when I feel good. Rejoice in the Lord always. Always. That means in every circumstance. That means in every circumstance. You're brought to the place you are, the battle you face, to rejoice in the Lord, to have your confidence in Him, to know that He is more than able. He is more than able. He is more than able. And He's made you a conqueror. A conqueror means you win. It does not mean you are defeated. It means you win. Some of us need to make a sign for our house. I am more than a conqueror through Christ who loved me and gave Himself for me. I am more than a conqueror. I will no longer be defeated. I will no longer allow the enemy to walk all over me. And then another one to be good is that I'm not my own. I'm bought with a price. I thought a good one for most people to set it on top of their TV. Not only that one, I'm not bought with a price, but set no evil thing before your eye. That's not a request either. That is a covenant relationship with the Father. Set no evil thing before your eye. Praise you, Jesus. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing. Don't worry. Don't be concerned. Don't try to figure it out. Be careful for nothing. Don't stress about it. That is, now what are we going to do? How are we going to fix this? We didn't make enough money this month, and how are we going to pay all the bills? You take the bills and you say, Father, in Jesus' name, You are our provision. You are our provider. You are the way maker. Hallelujah. I tell you what, it is so fun to watch God be the provider. It is fun. We do not set a budget, and we haven't for years, because it wouldn't be a good idea. We just know there's bills, and we pay them in the name of Jesus. And He always provides all of our needs according to His riches and glory. Not ours, His. That's His promise. I'm His child. He will provide for us according to His riches and glory in Christ Jesus. Just trust in Him. And He'll do exceedingly abundantly more than you ask or think. As you take a hold of He as your provider. A lot of us have not because we ask not. And then we ask amiss. We ask for something that is totally all consumed upon our own lust instead of on what Father's doing and hooked up with what Father's doing, because He laid the principle, you seek Me and I'll take care of you. You seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and I'll take care of you. And He does a real good job of it. But it gets messed up when we get in there figuring it out and trying to do it. I tell you what, people, prayer works. Don't stress, pray. Right here, that's what it's saying. Don't stress, don't worry, don't concern yourself, pray. But in everything, by prayer and supplication with
thanksgiving.
This is how we pray. Prayer and supplication. Prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Not with, oh, God. Oh. You know, the church is just like so about, you know, just beating themselves up and mourning. And sorrow and sadness. Oh, God, have mercy upon me, a sinner. Wait! Aren't you washed in the blood of Jesus Christ?
Yes.
He's redeemed you. He's made you righteous as He is righteous.
Amen.
With thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. Let your request be made known unto Him. You have not because you ask not. If your Father on earth If you ask him for a piece of bread, and your daddy loves you, you got a good daddy, and he loves you, and you ask him for a piece of bread, he's not going to give you a stone. If you ask him for a piece of fish, he's not going to give you a snake. Some people eat snake. I don't care for it. I've never tried it and don't want to. I'm going to ask for the fish. And I want trout in fresh water. And that's it. If I'm having fish, I want trout in fresh water. Well, bass in fresh water is not bad. So if you want mullet that eats the bottom of the ocean, then you can ask for that. I'm over here with what I want to ask for. And if your Father here on earth will give you good things, how much more your Father which is in heaven? It's his pleasure to give us the kingdom.
Yes, it is.
And that's where our focus, when our focus is in the kingdom, we don't concern ourselves with earthly things. We're not concerned about them because our focus is in my Father that is in heaven. What he's doing and doing it with him. Participating with him. Thank you, Jesus. And the peace of God which passes all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds. Peace of God. When you apply the word of God to your life and you live it, Christians walk around all the time going, what do I do? I need a counseling session. And I mean, you know, some people do. We need to walk people through things. But if you would let the Holy Spirit counsel you through the word of God, and you just go, I need peace. Where's peace? Lord, right now I need peace. Look it up. Google the word. Take your little thing and type in peace on your little Bible searcher thing. Peace. Look it up. How to get peace. We should do a blog. How to receive peace. How to have love. How to have joy. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and mind. And then right here again, it's just like Psalms chapter 1, giving us instruction not to walk in the counsel of the ungodly or stand in the way of sinners or sit in the seat of the scornful. But our delight is in the law of the Lord, and in it we do meditate day and night. It's like that. It says, finally, brethren, do these things right here. Here's how to stay over here. You enter right here through that prayer and supplication instead of being worried and concerned and stressed out about everything and trying to figure it out and how we're going to make it work. How are you going to make what work? God's kingdom and yours. Ouch. God's kingdom or your kingdom? Because he's going to supply all your needs when you're focused on him. When you're realizing that I'm not my own, but I'm bought with a price. And then he gives further instructions, and it's beautiful here. And he just tells you what to think about. He tells you what to meditate on. He tells you what should be going on in your thought life and in your heart. Thought, the inner man. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. I didn't see anything about getting mad at anybody. I didn't see anything about anger. I didn't see anything about stressing out, being upset. I didn't see any evil report in this. This is how to stay over in the peace that passes all understanding. And there's several people in this place that don't know how to stay in the peace. So the Holy Spirit's just slowing down and catching you up. And he's so good to that. He's so good about that. He loves his people. And if you will just take a hold of these principles, you should jot these things down. If you don't have it, you should write it down and go back to it. I haven't learned to stay in the peace, so this is instructions on how to stay in the peace. When somebody makes me mad, I get over here and I'm like, rimmer, rimmer. I'm going to fix their little red wagon. But I mean, You know, this is the thought life of a lot of people. And they may cool it down in a little bit and just go, okay, God, forgive me. I'm not supposed to be over there. But, I mean, you shouldn't have gone there in the first place. Have the peace of God rule your mind instead of all of the confusion so your focus can be on the kingdom of heaven. We don't want to be tossed to and fro with every, not even wind of doctrine, but every little thing that comes our way. We want to be firm and with our hearts set on the purposes and the plans that God has for our life. We want to run our race. We want to finish our course. And we want to run it well. We want to obtain the prize that is set before us. And you're not going to obtain a prize in a race if you're stopping every few minutes and fixing something on your own. You are going to be one of the last ones across the finish line. In Ephesians chapter 6. And before, I'm just going to read verse 18, but before verse 18, there are a lot of instructions here. On how to walk with God and be an overcomer and be victorious. You go back and you read it. Assignment. But verse 18, praying always with all prayer. Praying always. Praying how often?
Always.
Always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. In the Spirit. Not man's way of praying. Get out of it. Because man's way of praying will leave you in a mournful state, in a sorrowful state. I'm telling you, the worst thing that you could think of could happen to you. And you get down on your face before the Father and He will fill you. And it will, that joy will surpass whatever you're dealing with. It will surpass it. You will have the peace that passes all understanding. It will rule your heart and mind. If you know you're getting ready to go through something tough, then you pray for the peace that passes all understanding.
Right.
You ask God to give you, okay, Father, I'm getting ready to walk through this, and it's a little bit big for me. Now, Father, I just thank you that give me peace that passes all understanding, a peace that I can't comprehend and nobody else around me can comprehend, but they just look at me and just go, how are you standing here in so much peace? Because I trust Him. I asked, and He's not given me a snake. He's not given me a stone. He's given me peace that passes all understanding. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, watching. That's vigilance, watching what's going on. You know, a lot of times things sneak up on us because we're not watching. And in praying for other people and having the responsibility to undergird other people, watching in the Spirit, listening to the Lord say, pray for this now, do this now. There needs to be more prayer here. Because He has us pray people through. Isn't God amazing? He has us be there to pray when they can't realize how much God will pick them up and carry them and take them through their struggles and their battles and their issues. God has those that will intercede and pray and undergird until you learn to stand and walk with Him. So that's a watching. You're a watchman. And you're watching and waiting for Him to come at any moment. It's a diligent watching. It's a vigilant, valiant watching, thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Watching. Not just this is our job. All of us. Not just the people that stand behind the podium, but everyone. This is to the whole body. It was written to the Ephesians to be passed down to us in this day and time that we all are watching and praying and persevering. Pray without ceasing. Continue in prayer. Instant in season. Instant in prayer. Instant. At a moment, you're praying because you stay in that place of prayer. Praying and interceding for everyone around you, watching, building yourself up in your most holy faith, praying in the Spirit. And then that place of prayer of authority. And that is just like powerful, studying that out, the authority that Jesus Christ has given us, and praying in authority. Coming to that place where we're just like, and it happens. And you pray in authority when you know Father says, do this. And you cooperate with it. You cooperate with what Father's saying, and you know it's done, and that's their place of authority. And it can be a whisper, it can be a shout, whatever, but it's authority. And when Jesus spoke, he spoke right out of heaven. He spoke right out of what Father was doing, and everything he said happened. Everything he commanded to happen happened. Not one time was there fail. Not one time did someone not get healed. Not one time did a dead person not raise. Not one time when Jesus said for it to happen, it happened. And he says, I give you all power and authority. Whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. I give you this power. I give you this authority. And what is God's church doing with this power and authority that Christ has given us? He said, go wait for the promise. You get the promise, and then you're endued with power. Power, authority by the Holy Ghost. God's looking for people that will speak with authority because they've been alone in the secret place and they've learned how to take a hold of it. You know, there's the prayer of repentance. And that's a good prayer. But we're supposed to move on from the prayer of repentance to entering into his gates and coming in to this place in God, to where we're turning the armies of the aliens to flight, to where we're doing something in the kingdom, to where we're praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. For all the saints, to where we're stepping up to a place of authority and we're praying and speaking the word of God. It's a prayer. It's speaking the word of God right out of heaven. And what we declare happens because that is the authority that was passed to the church. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And we saw the disciples get up and run with it. We saw Peter being changed from a man that went and hid out after he denied Jesus. With all the rest of the 10 disciples, Peter and the rest of them were all hid out, hiding in a good hiding place so nobody could find them, they hoped. And they were peeking through, hoping nobody was coming after them. And we saw how when the Holy Ghost came on Peter, he changed into another man and he got right up in their face and began to preach and declare the word of God.
Amen.
Because when God's saying do it, there were times that God said get up and leave the city, go to the next place. You know, you preached and, you know, escaped to the next place and preached. You know, some people, because they don't know the word of God, they don't know how Paul and Peter handled things and how Paul was let down in a basket to go into the next place and how, you know, there were many times that he had to leave and go to the next place because he would be killed if he would have stayed there. And they don't know that, and so they try to get up with that authority because they're not listening and try to get up with authority and do the same thing, and then they find themselves killed before the time, their time, because they didn't know that they were supposed to escape. The Chinese teach you to escape so you can go to the next place because there's not enough people preaching the gospel. So we got to have everybody. So you run and you escape because they looked at the word of God and prepared themselves for what they're going through. We need to look at the word of God and prepare ourselves for what we're going to go through in this country. There's a time to stand up by the Holy Spirit, speak the word, and then go to the next city and speak the word, and then go to the next city and speak the word, and then go to the next place and speak the word with power and authority. And I tell you, people, we want to be functioning in that power and that authority for the days that are ahead. We want to prepare ourselves now. If we can't even be thankful for every situation that we're in, if we can't have thanksgiving for what we're going through now, how are we going to go through it when there's persecution on the church so much that you could die or be put in prison or whatever for preaching the gospel in this nation? Because if God's people don't humble themselves and pray and seek his face and change the atmosphere of this country for which there is still hope in our day and time. But if we don't turn the battle to the gate in this country, it looks to me like the church has been sleeping and wickedness over with just a few people is trying to take over our country and dominate our country. And where there's evil and there's ungodliness and there's wickedness in a nation, the blessing of God is pulled back and persecution will come to the church of God. To wake up the church, to make them realize, well, it's going to separate the wimps from the real men of God. It's going to separate those that are just wolves in our midst, that are just trying to take finances from the sheep and what they want, their own gain from people. It's going to separate them from the real men and women of God, because when you are going to have to die for what you say, when it's going to cost you for what you say, and even now we see in our country where people have had to, they've had to go to court. There's a preacher in Texas that had to go to court because he got up and he declared the word of God against sodomy, that it is wrong, that it's evil, that God's against it. And he had, you know, and that was called hate speech. And he had to say, and he said, he goes, I'm not against those people. I was just saying what the word of God says. But I mean, it seemed kind of just a little bit majorly pulling back on what he declared. But we have to be able to declare the word of God. We cannot be afraid to declare the word of God. And we have to say what it says. If you're a real man of God or a woman of God, you'll stand up and you'll tell the truth when God tells you to, and you won't back down and you won't be afraid. Even if it costs you your life, even if it costs you being in prison. And prison's not a pretty place to go. Jail's not a pretty place to go. But that's what's heading for our country, and we have got to be aware of where we're at. So we want to be like Paul and Silas in the prison. They were beaten, and they were begin to worship and praise the Lord and rejoice in the Lord. And everybody around heard them. After they had been beaten, you think about that, they had been beaten. And here they are rejoicing and praising God, that, and they were probably, part of their worship was, Lord, we were accounted worthy to bear the stripes for your name's sake on our back. Hallelujah.
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 You know, I can't think of a lot of people that would be happy, even in this place, because we grumble and murmur over little bitty things. God wants us to have those things change. He wants us to speak a blessing and be a blessing and be thankful in everything. In everything, for this is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus. You're in this situation because it's the will of God for me? Yeah. So you can get to the next place in Him. And Paul and Silas are in that prison and they're rejoicing in the Lord because they've been beaten. And all of a sudden the chains fall off. Comes undone. The little clamps that go around their arms and their feet. It comes undone. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Because they were thankful. But you know what happened out of all of that? Somebody gave their life to Jesus. They came in and they fell down on, the guard came down and fell on his knees and he goes, what must I do to be saved? Believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved, and your house.
Right.
And your house.
Amen.
And he took them and he washed their stripes.
Yep.
And he took care of them. And his house gladly received the gospel of Jesus Christ. God will bring you to prison to reach a guard and his family. Isn't that amazing what God will do?
Yes.
If you'll be thankful.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I tell you what, to go through that, to see somebody saved, it's amazing. And most of us won't go across the street to tell somebody about Jesus. We'll just argue with the Lord about it. But we're all called. Because he told us everyone to go into, he said, when you receive power, go and be a witness. Have you received power? Then that means you're supposed to go and be a witness. If you haven't received the power of the Holy Ghost, then you have a reason not to be a witness. But if you've received power, and the Baptists haven't received the power, but they're good witnesses. They focus on soul winning. Hallelujah, Jesus. I thank you, Father, that your church is going to be thankful and get out of the cares, riches, and pleasures of this world. I mean, we are just spoiled, rotten brats in America. We have no idea. We're trained up to just me, take care of. And how am I going to get through the day? And what are we going to eat for breakfast, lunch, and dinner? And what are we going to wear? And what are we going to do? And what kind of entertainment and what kind of vacation are we going to go on this year? And so much of us that we're as God. So much. God gets a little bit here and there. I mean, just lay it on a balance, as Pastor Marcus said. What's for you and what's for the Lord? Are you not your own? Do you belong to Him or do you belong to you? Who do you belong to?
God, Jesus.
Well, then we're to give Him everything. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus, for the glory of your presence. The glory of your presence. Glory and honor to your name, Jesus. Thank you, Father. You know, I want to turn over to Romans real quick.
Amen.
Chapter 8. You want to be sitting in here when the Lord's dealing with stuff like this, and you want to be saying, Lord, I surrender all. You don't want to be going, well, why are we, and, you know, any of that pulling back and you know, trying to self-justify or, you know, most of my life is for God or, yeah, you want to be, yes, Father, yes, Lord. These places right here, Father, I have held on to my life. I have held on to my tongue. I have held on. Lord, and I'm surrendering them to you. I'm letting go right now. You want to look and say, Lord, I am letting go. Not my way, but your way, Lord. Lord, I'm seeing what the Word of God says. And I'm going to allow the change of the Spirit in my life. We need to count it all done. As Paul did. And I mean, he listed out what all he had been, a Pharisee of Pharisee, of the tribe of Benjamin. I mean, he was up there. He had position. He had power. He had authority in his nation. He was honored. He was respected for who he was and what he had accomplished. And he said, I count it all done. He just wanted to know him. After all those years of serving the Lord and all that he gave for God and all the persecution and the imprisonment and the stripes and the stonings, he said, that I might know him. That I might know him. And that's where our heart wants, we want our heart to be, that I might know him. Lord, I'm sorry for holding on to me, that I might know you. That I might know you in the fellowship of your suffering. That request, that I might know you. Lord Jesus. Nothing in this world matters. But knowing him and knowing when you stand before him on that day, you have finished your course. You have run your race well. You have done what he's called you to do. Because everything is going to be laid out before him. And there's going to be hay, wood, and stubble. And anything that can be burned by fire, of all the things that you've done your entire life, if it can be burned by fire, it's going to be burnt up. And then what's left is all you'll have to present before the king. I want something to present before the king.
Me too.
I want a lot to present before the king. And we have the choice of living our life or living the life that he's laid out before us. But I will tell you, if you get caught up in living your life, you will probably not continue on to know the Lord. At some point, you'll get trapped. At some point, you may even be able to sit in church, but there'll be that deception that you're just going to go on and do what you're doing and live it the way you're living. Young people, I will tell you, you don't want to choose what's ahead of you. You want to give your life to the Lord because you don't want to marry the wrong person.
Amen.
And how to keep from marrying the wrong person is don't date them.
That's right.
Don't think about dating them. Don't entertain that thought. Don't hang out with them. If you're very interested in them, you want to take it before the Lord and wait on the Lord.
Amen.
And the best way to do that, first of all, is take it to your mama and your daddy and say, I kinda. And if your mama and daddy aren't stupid, if you don't have one that's like, oh, well, yeah, he's kinda cute. There's parents that's stupid. I'm not kidding. I mean, it was a serious matter with me and David. It was serious. I'd wake up in the middle of the night going, oh, God, no, 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 no. No, 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 no. Oh, God, spare us. I did. And thank God, I prayed through every one of my in-laws, and I knew it was sent from heaven. I knew that my son-in-law, my daughter-in-laws were sent from heaven. God gave them to me because they need me to help them get to heaven. And I'm going to walk them through it, and I'm going to see them over in the realms of glory, doing everything God's called them to do. And I'm not going to look at what anything the enemy might be doing. I'm going to look at what Jesus does, and I'm going to look at his eternal purposes, and I'm going to look that he is going to finish that work that he started. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And that's what you want to do. As parents, you want to get on your face and cry out before the Lord. And you want to know that this is a yes or this is a no. And so you just teach your kids, you don't make that decision. God makes that decision. And we do it in divine order. And we start with telling our parents. And if we feel like, and if the parents feel like it's going to go any further, then we take it to the leadership of the church. Before one day, before you go over to that tree. Because it could really be the tree that you're not supposed to touch.
Right.
And I do not know why I'm talking about this.
Holy Ghost,
Holy Ghost talking about.
But there's a divine order. And if the parents feel like it's right to go ahead, don't go there until you take it to the leadership of the church. And you let them pray about it and seek God about it. Because so many people have had a call of God upon their life. And they did what they wanted to do. They thought Mr. Wright or Mrs. Wright came along. And they did what they wanted to do. And they missed out on the calling of God because the spouse would not allow them to fulfill that calling. Because, you know, they're married and they have a child, and before they know it, they're in this relationship and the spouse will not cooperate with the calling of God. And so then you miss the calling. I have seen so many people and their hearts broken. I knew I was called to the mission field and I could not go because I married the wrong person. He was in the church. He looked like he was on fire for God, but he was a pretender. He wasn't the right one for me. That's a sad state to find yourself in, a sad situation. You want to know that what you're doing is what God wants you to do. You are dealing with your life on this earth. And it's a long time. And by the time that's over, you're basically both dead. So you want to know. You want to know in that instant. See, but so many people, that's right there, right in the church, it happens because people hold on to their own life. We have people leave the church to go marry somebody. And I've told you before about my husband's cousin, that he wasn't finding that woman in the church. And, you know, he was looking, and he just had to have a wife. He had to have a wife. He had to have a wife. He wasn't, his eyes weren't set on Jesus. It was like, I want Jesus and I want a wife. I want Jesus and I want a wife. I got to have a wife. You know, and it's fine to ask the Lord for a wife. My husband was saying he was just going to serve God. He wasn't going to have a wife. And he got a wife, whether he liked it or not. But Doug was just determined that, you know, and he says, okay, God, if you don't have me a wife by this time right here, then I'm going to leave the church and I'm going to go find a wife. And he left the church because God's not going to be dictated to.
That's right.
You're not going to tell God what you're going to do. There's a place of command ye me, and that's authority, but it's participating with what God's doing. It's like Moses, pick up your rod and tell the waters to part.
Yep.
Do it. I've given you that place on earth. I've given you that place of authority and power on earth. And that's a different command. You're not going to command things like that with God on this. And so he left the church and got a wife, and buddy, did he pick a doozy. And that was a train wreck from day one. And I won't even get into the garbage that went on, but it didn't last long. And then a little girl was raised up out of the midst of that pitiful, pitiful, ungodly, wicked, evil situation. He married one of the most evil women that you could even think of marrying. She didn't look like it. She came to church. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And I mean, we had a fiery church. But we knew. We said, no, Doug. But he had to walk through it. And then a child brought up out of that, and her life was a complete train wreck, and she was worse than her mother. And you don't even want to hear the mess. It was a mess. It'd make the hair stand up on the back of your neck. That's why there is divine order, and there is the church, and there is protection in the church. There's protection in the body. We must function together as a body. And it seems like I'm way away from where I was going. But the body ministry, the body is so imperative. It's so imperative. You can't be out there on your own and do anything. Even if you feel like you're called to be an evangelist, apostle, a prophet, or whatever, you have to be under submission to someone somewhere. You have to be in a local body somewhere. You have to have those that are over you in the Lord. And it is good for you to have to submit stuff. You should be submitted to the Lord anyway, and you should be happy about doing it because your life's not your own. You bought with a price. That's that American freedom that people are caught up on. And we've gone so far from God with that stuff and with holding on to our own life. And, you know, well, we've got to have a job and we've got to have eat and we've got to do this and we've got to do that. You can do it all in the Lord. Paul was a tent maker while he did what God told him to do. Paul said, my own hands have provided for my necessities. I have taken nothing from you. Nothing from you. Isn't that amazing? My own hands have provided for me. He had a job. He took care of himself and he took care of all the needs that he had and he took care of those around him as he traveled in the ministry. But he did it God's way. And so that's it. What we do God's way. And as we're working along, we're looking for those Priscillas and Aquilas and all those people that God brings, the Timothys and whoever God's bringing in our direction to hook up with us in ministry, to give, bring them to the Lord, to establish churches, and on and on and on, whatever the call is in your life, if you participate in what he's called you to do, then everything else falls in line.
That's right.
And then you're not living a miserable life that you never fulfilled what God called you to do because you got stuck over here in another realm. You got stuck in a place that you shouldn't have been stuck in because you did not walk in the perfect will and plan of God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Every one of us need to be completely surrendered to God in every area, and we need to look at the places that we've allowed ourselves to walk over here and have control. And we need to say, Father, is this what you're telling me to do? We need to just step back and say, Father, is this the tent making you want me to do? Is this the place you want me to be? Am I following you exactly where you've called me to be right now? Especially if you're not being fulfilled, if you don't feel fulfilled in what you're doing. And don't go, but this is what I've done, I went to school for, and this is my life vocation, and this is hanging on to my life, hanging on to my life, hanging on to my life, hanging on. Don't go like that. Go, Father, I want to be in the perfect plan that you have for me right now. I want to run my race well, and I want to finish my course. I want to do it your way, and I want to stand before you, and you say, you ran the race well. It's so simple to walk away because like I said about Paul, he said, Pharisee of Pharisee. Well respected, well honored in his community, as I just said. But he walked completely away from that authority and that power and that position he had. And he learned how to make tents with his hand. He never had to do that. He could have stayed right over there where he was. Because that was his vocation. And God, you have to use me here because this is my vocation, because this is what I decided to do. This was my plan with my life. And so you have to use me here as a Pharisee. Because I have to stay in my position. And I have to stay. But no, Paul counted his life dung. And he followed Jesus wherever he led him. Through every persecution, through every trial, through everything. And he counted it all joy. And he was exuberant about it. And that's God's call for every one of you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now, just will you all stand with me? Thanksgiving and worship and praise and glory, rejoicing and joyful and dancing before him and surrendering our life and knowing that we are in him and he is in us and we're not our own. If the Lord is speaking to some of you, I want you to come and I want you to get prayed for. Definitely. I want everyone to have an opportunity to come and worship the Lord with what he's blessed you with, because as you give, he can increase. And if you need increase, then you want to find something to give so it can be multiplied.
Yes.
And so we want to give everybody the opportunity to do that, but we want to pray for that. I want to pray for those in particular, and I want you to tell me as I pray for you that, you know, the Lord's speaking to you on this, and you felt like the Lord was checking some things in your spirit. And don't sit there and question it and work it all out and talk yourself out of it before you actually just, you know, say, look, the Lord just hit my heart with a certain thing that the Lord was saying here. But then anybody that wants prayer, we want to give you an opportunity to get prayer also tonight. But we just thank you, Father, right now in the name of Jesus, that the change comes. Father, we thank you that your word goes forth and it does not return void. Father, but it goes forth to do that thing that you have purposed it to do. And Father God, as you have spoke by your Holy Spirit, Lord, in this place tonight, Father, we just thank you. We thank you, Father, that your word pierces the heart of every person, and that we have plowed up the ground, and if we haven't, we plow it up, and we let the seed go in there, and we let it grow, and we let it have its purpose and its plan by the Spirit in us, that we walk out all that you've called us to walk out in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
The realms of your glory and the realms of your anointing.
Lord.
We praise you, Jesus. We praise you, Jesus. As everyone comes and you worship the Lord with what you've been giving, I would be glad to pray for anybody. But we want to praise him and worship him and thank Him for all that He has done for us. Even when it seems like we're in the midst of a fiery trial, that's where we want to worship Him the most. It's in the toughest time. We want to rejoice. We want to be thankful. We want to be so exuberantly happy at all times. When it looks like it's going rough and tough, and it looks like people don't like you, you want to rejoice in the Lord. You just praise Him. You just praise Him. You praise Him. Because you will praise your way out of everything that the enemy is trying to do against you. And you'll get stronger and stronger and stronger and more fit for the battle and more ready to be more than a conqueror continually in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Is there anything in particular you want me to pray for?